Oh yeah! Oh yeah! Let's do it! Clap it up, folks! Come on! Stupid for Movies and Devin Faraci is here! Come on! By the way, let me tell you about Devin Faraci. If you don't already know, of course you already know about Devin Faraci. By the way, I'm Mark Kaiser. Devin with BadassDigest.com, very well known around town. All the junkets, all the screenings. He was with Chud. He was such a great writer at Chud. Now he's at BadassDigest.com. Let me tell you what he's doing tonight. He is drinking. In the tradition of all of our guest hosts, he is getting wasted.
That's three in a row.
That is three in a row.
Three guests in a row drinking. Now, I didn't ask. I didn't go, do you want a beer? He's like, yeah, beer? I think maybe I did.
Well, I heard you mention a beer. I heard there was a beer being offered, and then so I was like, okay.
All right.
I like the cut of their jib. I like this a lot.
Yeah, this may be on me. Yeah.
And by the way, we have some crystal meth right down here. I don't know if that's something that you're interested in.
It's gone. It's gone.
I was sober for 6 years, and then I came here.
Oh.
Yeah, so thanks, guys. Thanks.
Once again, we've corrupted another. Fantastic. So anyway, so here's the thing. As you know, we did not do a show last week. We do a show every other week because right now we're in our Kickstarter phase. Mike, we do the Kickstarter thing. Mike, why don't you tell everybody about the Kickstarter?
We have a lower third for Kickstarter.
What?
Somewhere. Oh, well, anyway. Kickstarter. We are doing a Kickstarter campaign. We are raising money. There's like 32 days left, which means when you're listening to this podcast, watching it, whatever you're doing right now, go to Kickstarter.com, Streaming Garage, type that in, and we are giving out all sorts of rewards, they call them. If you give like $100, you get a backstage pass, which means we turn on the cameras 2 hours before the show or so, and you get to see all the stuff that goes on backstage.
There's cool stuff like it's that. So fantastic.
We're giving away hats and t-shirts.
Yes.
And all kinds of stuff like that. So, and basically, if we don't raise the money, this show's canceled. No, this show's canceled. Done. There's the website right there. So we got three more episodes of this till August 1st, and then we're pulling the plug on your ass, Kaiser.
How about Devin?
Well, maybe Devin will bring
all
the money tonight.
Well, I was told I had to pay to be here.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, yeah, right? $18,600 is going to cost you to be here.
Yeah, okay.
So give to your Kickstarter right now. Maybe during the show I'll give away something if somebody donates to me. I can see if you donate. Maybe you get one of these shirts, which we're not giving away in the Kickstarter.
If you donate $100, I'll give away the ending of Transformers 2-3 so you don't have to go see it. That's what I'll do.
I like this guy.
So, yes, please support Kickstarter. It's to do all these shows. We've got 125 hours with Stripped Down Live and Stupid for Movies and now Super Scary Horror Theater and the Dexter Show. And we've done all this for free for about 18 months. Nobody's been paid. And it's about time we get paid. And we're raising $20,000, which means nobody's going to still get their rate. It's like $100 a person for a certain amount of shows. So we're still not getting a lot of money, but we'd appreciate your help.
Mike is sounding desperate, and there's a reason for that. The reason for that is we're desperate.
Show's canceled.
That's why we sound desperate. By the way, thank you for everyone who has already participated in the Kickstarter campaign. Thank you.
G. Baudet just says he already put in his $10 on Ustream. Thank you.
There it is. G. Baudet, everyone. Let's give him a hand. Come on.
So
the
far,
longest journey begins with the smallest step.
The biggest prize given away so far is a $200 prize. Which not only gets you like our Flickr backstage, our backstage cameras, and then you get a shout out in the credits and all that. We have a show called Stupid for Dexter, and it's a kill room. Looks like the kill room in Dexter, and we're putting up pictures as Dexter does. And for $200, you get your picture in our kill room, so you see it at the opening credits, and all during the show, your picture will be part of the set design.
That's great. Whose show is this, by the way? Seriously, Dexter, who cares? Okay, first of all, let me tell you something. We have Rodman Flender's on the show tonight. Rodman Flender is a documentary director who did this great documentary that Devin saw, liked.
Did.
I saw it, liked.
Good.
Called Conan O'Brien Can't Stop. It's a terrific documentary. I highly recommend you check it out. Rodman is here to talk about the documentary, talk about maybe Roger Corman, who he used to work for and with, and would occasionally maybe even pay him to do that. And he'll be on later to talk about that, right, Rodman?
I will, yes.
You're not leaving during the show for any particular reason. You have no place to go.
What are my options?
Well, our last show was 2.5 hours.
Yeah.
And I promise you that will not happen.
No, let's make it longer.
I like that Colin Hanks, who was the guest, he still is tweeting. Like, Sam Levine and him are friends, and me, we're all friends. And Sam Levine always writes when the Cubs win. He writes, Cubs win. And every day on Twitter now when he does that, Colin Hanks writes back, oh, I wouldn't know. I'm still at the Streaming Garage. So he's still giving a shit that the show was that long.
So you had no idea that this is what you were in for?
No, I paid you guys $10,000 to come here,
nice.
And I heard that I'm going to be stuck here for 6 to 7 hours today.
Yes.
Is this the story?
Yes.
Oh, boy.
By the way.
When do the pants come off?
Huh?
The pants. When did they come out?
Not a moment too soon. As okay.
March pants.
Especially
or...
if you keep drinking. By the way, I have to say that Devin, who goes to all the junkets, you must get all the swag in the world. You must get all the plush toys, all the books, everything they send out, you must get.
I get some crap.
Yeah. It's mostly crap.
It's all crap, yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
What, so, okay, as an example, let you guys know what it is that film journalists and critics like Devin get. Give us an example of something you've gotten recently, like maybe for Transformers, which we'll talk about in a second.
I got a whole box of Transformer toys. I got, like, all these little robots, and I got an Optimus Prime mask that has real D3D glasses built into it, so you can wear an Optimus Prime mask while you go see Transformers 3. I got that. I didn't wear it while going to see Transformers 3.
You know, that's actually kind of cool.
Is it?
I don't know. Maybe it is.
It's real little.
Really?
Yeah, I put it on. It gave me a headache.
So Transformers, now what's the coolest piece of swag you have ever gotten in the history of your life?
That's a great question. I got a really cool letter opener from The Fountain, Darren Aronofsky's The Fountain, and it was in the shape of a Mayan sacrificial dagger. That was pretty cool.
That is cool.
That is cool. I had that for a while.
Now, do you have now, you were with Chud,
mm-hmm.
and now you're with Badass Digest.
Correct.
And here's the thing with Badass Digest. It's run by the Alamo Drafthouse guys.
It's owned by, we're sort of arm's length, so I can say bad things about movies that they're showing in the theater. But it's my boss is Tim League, who runs the Alamo.
Now, just for people who don't know, because they really should, because I am so in love with the Draft House, what they do, what they're about. Just for a moment before we talk about Transformers right. and Larry Crowne, tell us just about the Alamo Draft House philosophy and how they work.
Well, it's possible that your viewers probably heard about us recently, because there was this whole thing where there was this woman who came into the Draft House where we have a very strict policy about texting and talking. You just don't do it. And she texted, and she was warned, and she kept texting, and she was warned again. And she kept texting, so we threw her out. And she left this really angry, ridiculous message on the answering machine at the theater. And we turned it into a PSA about why you shouldn't text in theaters. And, we're really stringent about it. But what's really great is this isn't like some kind of like snotty kind of situation. Like, the Alamo has food and beer. You get served food while you're watching the movie, and you'd be surprised it doesn't interfere with the movie at all. And it's a pretty cool system. We show new movies, we show old movies. We have quote-along, sing-along. We do a thing, the Action Pack recently, where we showed RoboCop and gave the audience cap guns so they can shoot back at the screen. So, I mean, you know, there's a lot of fun to be had, and that's sort of... Our thing is that, you know, exhibition... People are saying that, you know, there's piracy and the exhibition's hurting... Well, make exhibition fun. You know, make the movie theater a destination, not something that you have to deal with. Because now I go to the theater here, and you know, you have kids talking, you have babies crying in an R-rated movie, you have all the texting in the world, people answering their phones. It's a nightmare. Make theatrical experience part of the whole reason why you're going out. You're having a great time, and you're also seeing a really good movie.
Well, the one thing I'll say about Draft House, and then we'll move on, is that yes, it's fun, and they have all these gimmicks, but there's that foundation of respect and love for movies.
Well, that's the thing, yeah. I mean, when we're showing a movie, you know, we might do quote-alongs or sing-alongs, but when we're showing a movie for a regular screening of a movie, it is silent appreciation. And our thing also is we show a lot of older movies, a lot of really weird movies, and our belief is that you're not smarter than the movie. You can laugh with the movie. We kind of like when you laugh at the movie. So it's fun to have fun at the movies, but it's also great to really enjoy them, respect them, and appreciate them.
Well, you know, I'll say no one is more used to being laughed at than me. I'll just say that.
God
as
bless.
We move on to This Weekend in Movies, cue the graphic. Look at that, the fanciness. Yes. Look at that.
I like to go on Kickstarter.
Huh? No. So what you're saying is we want you to go on Kickstarter.com and give us money, which we will then use for more beer for Devin Faraci. Or we kill this dog, Corey says. That's what happened. And then later on we have Rodman Flender. One over here. Later on we have Rodman Flender.
Yeah.
All right, so first let's talk about Transformers, the one about the auto jiggers and the whatever the hell they are.
Yeah, it's...
I think it's autoerotic asphyxiation.
I don't know what they are. Oh, PNXS.
Weird.
So, Devin, tell us about that.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, Transformers Dark of the Moon, the third movie from Michael Bay, based on a toy line. This is what it is, right? And this one is better than the last one, and it almost has a story this time. Sam, our hero, played by the ever-punchable Shia LaBeouf, is he's got problems in his life because he's got a really beautiful Victoria's Secret girlfriend, which sucks. And then he's best friends a robot car, which is awful. And then that's trouble for him. And then the evil robots are doing bad things and shooting other robots. And then people shoot each other for 60 minutes at the end of the picture. That's essentially the entire script of Transformers 3.
Oh, there's
I just
a script?
Read it to you. Rumor has it.
I didn't know that.
Rumor has it.
Now, it's funny because now we have a clip of the movie.
Yeah. We got a really, but we got a big, this is like, you're going to see where I think the clip we have, well, this is like a big ILM scene, I think.
This is a huge, huge action
this
sequence,
is a
folks.
Big scene.
A lot of money was spent on this scene. We got it for you. Let's take a look.
What is that?
This is your new lucky bunny.
What? It's a beautiful thought, Carly, but I don't think it's the whole bunny that's lucky. You see, it's just this section here. You see, it's just the rabbit foot that's lucky.
No, it's just a good luck charm. Help you think positive. Okay. Today's important. Come on, get up. Hey, wear that nice tie.
Yeah.
You need any money for lunch?
No, I don't need any money for lunch. I have money from yesterday's lunch.
You love it, don't you? I'm just your American boy toy.
I love a boy toy.
Man, what about that?
That, you know what? That rabbit, literally, there was about 8 weeks of rendering.
Yeah, there's no, there was no rabbit on set.
No.
There was also no woman. There still is no woman. That's, you know, not a real person.
Can I say something about a couple things?
It's your show.
No, it's our show. Because you
Thank
are the
you.
Guest host.
Thank you. Mazel
so you are here. Thank you. You. You know what? Let's toast that.
Thank
you with the beer, me with the Everclear. The thing with the woman is that, you know, she's getting knocked a lot for being horrible. But the fact is that it's a nothing role.
Right.
She's basically cheesecake.
Right.
So, the fact that it's a nothing role and she's just written to have a nice ass, that's not really her fault. I don't know that if you put an amazing actress in this film, it's that character will be any better. It's just, what it is.
In the movie, somebody's pointed out to me that in the film, she gets compared to a classic car and a beautiful dog. this is the sort of work that Michael Bay is doing. I think it's really impressive that he's really furthering the feminist cause in this way, in that the dog is gender neutral. We don't know which, it could be either.
That's true.
Either gender dog that she's being compared to.
Very forward thinking.
I think that's really positive. So,
well, yeah. Here's the thing with Bay. You know, all the knocks on Bay, we share them too. I mean, obviously the guy is a car fetishist. He's a woman fetishist. He's an explosion fetishist. He's all that stuff. Everything that the 14, 16-year-old boys like. You know, as incomprehensible and bad as the movie is, this is the first film I've seen, and I think we'll disagree on the merits of 3D. This is the first film I've seen where I think this film is better because of 3D, and I'll tell you why. As you know, 3D can limit what directors can do.
Right.
Because when you do 3D, as you know, when you do 3D, you can't have 20 frame shots and whip pans everywhere.
You can, but the audience will be vomiting.
They will be vomiting everywhere, yes. So Michael Bay knows this, and it forced him to back up a little bit and to let shots play out, even though it's fast moving and all that sort of stuff, and it really helps the film. So 3D actually helped the movie, and I thought that his use with 3D actually was decent. I'll tell you why. I like 3D not when people throw things at the screen. I like 3D when there's foreground, midground, background action, and I can start picking that apart.
Right.
And I think he does that. And by the way, if you think this means I like the movie, you're wrong, because the movie's terrible. You know, it's true that the last hour of the film is just one gigantic battle scene.
Right.
And, you know, the thing with Bay, and Zack Snyder is the same way too sometimes, but especially Bay, the thing with Bay is that when something is cranked up to 10 for that long a time, that can become just as boring as it's one.
That's the problem.
For that long a time.
The final action scene, it flatlines at a certain point, and there's no ebb and flow. There's no rhythm to that final hour, so it just sort of turns into like shout, scream, fall, shoot, explode, walk down the alley, shout, scream, fall, shoot, explode. And that's the big problem. Bay's technically a terrific filmmaker. I think it's as much as you want to make fun of the movies he makes or whatever, technically what he's doing in a scene and in a shot is often really great and better than a lot of other filmmakers. Unfortunately, he can't put this shit together to make a movie. And so it's this weird thing where there's the narrative structure is disastrous. This is a movie that it has, I swear to God, this has six or seven comedy relief characters jammed into the first hour, it is like a nightmare.
They have these little tiny robots.
It's got two little tiny robots. It's got Ken Jeong doing his standard Ken Jeong shtick, which everywhere.
By the way, the character's last name is Wang. Because that's funny, because Wang means penis, and I'm 14 years old, and that's clever to me.
It's got that. It's got John Malkovich in a comic relief role where he tries to box a robot, and then the robot tickles him. This is one of our finest actors, being tickled by a robot.
The guy's got boat payments. Give him a break.
It's got John Turturro, who was the most annoying part of the previous two movies, being one of the least annoying parts of this movie, which really lets you know. I mean, like, it's just... And then there's, like, comedy bad guy robots that, like, drool and stuff. This is an hour of this. He's so tone-deaf. His sense of humor is so horrible. It is like torture. It is hard for me to imagine anybody sitting through the first hour of that movie and not wanting to just kind of claw their eyes out.
Well, because ultimately, he's not really a storyteller or a character guy. He's just a scale guy. And from a scale perspective, there's some great shots in it. And the thing is that as much as I would love to just rip it all day long, the thing about the Transformer machines, those over-designed, crazy, I just still don't get them, is that unlike a lot of pure CGI creations in movies, these robots, when they're standing on the street or flying around, they have a certain amount of weight to them.
Right.
And that's difficult. Like, I remember in the first Spider-Man film, and you remember this, I remember in the first Spider-Man film, when Spider-Man would fly around, it would look like a bunch of ones and zeros flying around. It just felt like a weightless nothing. Yeah. And Spider-Man 2, they did a much better job.
Right.
With Transformers, I felt that those robots were these huge, massive, giant things destroying everything. You know, so, I mean, I'll give him that. I mean, when it comes to scale, he's great.
Well, here's the thing about Bay is that whatever his other problems are, he understands how to use digital elements with physical elements. And that's what makes it different. He's not creating just these giant cartoonscapes like so many other filmmakers do, where nothing on screen is real. There will be real actors in a real street in a real building with a real explosion and then a fake robot put into it. I think that really helps. I think that makes a big difference. It doesn't make the film any better or more watchable or make any more sense. The movie makes literally no sense at all. The plot makes no sense on any level. It's horrible.
Can I just say something?
I did not like this movie.
Can I say something?
Why are you making me talk about this?
Because you're getting drunker and drunker, and then you become the angrier and angrier critic.
So mad.
Here's the thing. Leonard Nimoy plays the super robot whose name is Steve
Sentinel,
or something.
Sentinel Prime.
His name is Steve. What is it? Sentinel Prime?
Sentinel Prime.
Okay. He plays Sentinel Prime. Now, there's at least four Star Trek references in the film,
right.
Mainly because they're both Paramount properties. Right. Let's sell DVDs, folks.
Well, and also because Michael Bay's so ham-handed that, like, showing Mr. Spock on a TV screen is his idea of, like,
That's so meta for him.
Oh, this is like an Easter egg.
Yes.
It's actual footage of Spock on a TV screen.
But, you know, there was a line in the movie, and you remember this, you heard it. There's a line when Leonard Nimoy, as Steve the Robot, whatever his stupid name is, he says, literally, the needs of the many outweigh the needs of the few. He says that as Steve Prime. And I'm like, that's like the theme of Star Trek II. I mean, that's like Spock said that actual line.
Right.
And I thought, all right, I'll give him 1 point for that.
Oh, I gave him no points. I'm a Star Trek nerd. So to see that line, which was beautiful moments in cinema history, as Mr. Spock, spoiler, dies. I know. Sorry, guys. To be used in the mouth of an evil robot was just
only because if Nimoy signed off on it, I'm okay with it.
I think the one thing Nimoy signed off on was his check.
That could be.
I think that's about it. He endorsed his check and everything else. Look, you know what happened? He shows up in a recording booth here in the Valley for like 25 minutes, records every line, and then goes home with a big check.
And then years later, there's a movie.
Right. That's it. Well, no, he actually did this, I think, about 7 weeks ago.
Is that right?
Yeah, I think he was like one of the last editions.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah.
Now, as a Star Trek fan, Brent Spiner, Data?
I'm not a Next Generation.
No. Oh. We just had him on live.
Don't name drop. How much did Brent Spiner give to the Kickstarter campaign?
Seriously.
He offered to pay for pizza. You've never done that once.
Damn right. All right, so here's the thing. So Transformers 2, we have nothing more to say about it except that if you're a 14-year-old boy, you will have your first orgasm during this film.
Otherwise, forget it.
Okay, so here's the thing. We have the buy, rent, or burn.
Right.
Right? So buy it if you should pay money to see it. Rent it if it's like, meh, or wait for it on DVD or streaming. Or burn it, which would mean it's...
Burn down the movie theater.
So you give it a buy, rent, or burn.
Oh, burn. Burn this motherfucker.
Devin Faraci gives it a burn.
Burn. Mark, apparently.
I apparently have given it a burn as well. Because it sucks.
It's shit. Shit.
How come he gets to swear? Everybody gets to swear. Every time I swear, Mike yells at me.
You can swear now.
Don't swear.
You can swear.
Huh?
When did you swear?
That's the point. I don't swear because Mike says make sure you don't swear.
No, there's statistically proven that you get more money by swearing. So feel free.
Really? Fucking
no.
A.
Oh, no, but you can't swear. Don't
do that. Oh, what? See, that's what I'm talking about.
We have sponsors watching. Why would you do that?
I get no respect on that.
I'm the bad boy. I swear I don't have a beer. So,
See? He's even worse than me.
I know.
All right, so now let's move on to Larry Crowne. Now, Larry Crowne is the... there he is, Larry Crowne. Now, Tom Hanks has not directed a film in 15 years. The last film he did was the terrific That Thing You Do, which I liked a lot. And you're thinking to yourself, That Thing You Do, terrific little film. What does he have up his sleeve next? We have to wait 15 years to find out. And unfortunately, the answer is Larry Crowne. And Larry Crowne stars Tom Hanks as the title character. He plays a former Navy chef who gets fired from his job at basically Walmart. And now he's set adrift. He's divorced. He's unemployed. Doesn't know what to do with his life. So he winds up going back to community college where he meets a teacher played by Julia Roberts. And as much as we love having Tom Hanks and Julia Roberts in a movie, it does feel like this is like 1991 or something, because that's really when their wheelhouse was. Now they're a bit, not over the hill, but they're a bit past their prime. Hanks is like 54 years old. You know, Roberts, I think, is around 43. So this does have a throwback flavor to it, but ultimately they don't have a lot of chemistry. And when we take a look at a clip, we'll talk a little bit more about them and then the movie.
Good morning, Larry.
Good morning.
Should I have been calling you Lance all this time?
Oh, no, only one person calls me Lance. Well, I had all their friends.
I met her. She's an interesting girl.
She's a unique bundle, yeah. All this, you know, my clothes are her idea.
I had actually put that together. You ready for your final?
Well, we'll find out.
I drew the order last night.
And?
You're last.
Lucky me.
Thank you, by the way.
What did I do?
Kept our secret.
Oh, yeah. I don't do many things well, but I can keep a secret.
Gentlemen do.
Allow me.
Now, there's two problems with the movie. One is the movie was written by Nir Vardalos, who wrote My Big Fat Greek Wedding. And the problem with her is that she wrote that film, which did very well, especially compared to its cost, and has since written nothing but crap, and this is really just another in the same line. The problem with Vardalos is that she's cutesy, she's sitcom phony, all the jokes are completely hack, and the fact is that that's not the kind of comedy that a movie like this needs, because when Hanks goes back to school, he winds up meeting this Benetton Rainbow Coalition of minorities, idealized Mexican-Americans and African-Americans who all help him because everyone loves aw shucks Larry Crowne. And the thing is that there's absolutely no conflict or reality to it. And, you know, you're talking about a film which is released during a horrible, recession where middle-aged people, just like the Tom Hanks character, they've been laid off and they can't find a job. And you're thinking to yourself, will this be sort of an up-in-the-air-ish movie where it at least takes a stab at the times we live in now? And you know what? Larry Crowne could not be farther from that. It treats its central conceit, which is a guy who's unemployed and doesn't know what to do with his life, it treats it like nothing. It's all about Tom Hanks getting together with these people, these young kids, these young, gorgeous young guys and gals who would never be friends with him unless this movie told them to be friends with him. And he winds up with Julia Roberts, who would never give him the time of day unless the script didn't say give him the time of day. And the only thing I did like about the film actually was Julia Roberts, because I felt like, unlike everybody else, playing this film for the bland pleasantries that is inherent in the script, at least Julia Roberts gave me a little bit of reality. I felt like because she was in a horrible marriage, she's married to Bryan Cranston from Breaking Bad, there was a little bit of darkness to that character that I thought I really, really appreciated, because the rest of it is just so sitcom and so cutesy and so unrealistic that I really just rebelled against it. You know, Devin, you know how when you see a movie's got maybe 10, 15 minutes to grab you. Mm-hmm. If it doesn't grab you after that, it's not going to grab you, ever.
Yeah. Yeah, if it doesn't have somebody getting their head cut off or boobs
it's in funny
10
because
minutes, I think.
Because
yeah, I'm out. I'm just done.
Because in the movie, Tom Hanks gets attacked by a monster.
Does he?
Yes, Optimus Prime.
Well, I was confused.
I really thought you were going to say Attack by a Monkey.
I was confused.
I love monkeys.
I was going to go see that.
How does this tie in, like, technically with the previous film, the Thomas Crown affair? How does that, what is the through line? Is there a thing at the end, an Easter egg, where we discover he's a jewel thief? Is that what it is?
You know what? Here's the thing. You know, when you look at a movie like this, you know, which has absolutely no drama, no conflict, characters you don't care about, right. A happy ending you already know is coming. And then you look at the Thomas Crown affair, right? It's a little edgy.
Right.
It's more fun. I'd rather see that movie.
Well, you know what's funny is that I haven't seen Larry Crowne, it's funny because you look at the advertising and nobody knows what the fuck this movie's even about. Like, it's not about anything. It's, like, so weird. The ads are just Tom Hanks and you know, on a Vespa, which is like, who is,
you know,
what is this, who is this, no, selling to?
Can I say
it's
something?
It's so weird.
This movie is such pablum. You know, he goes to the community college and he meets this this young woman, this gorgeous African-American actress named, I wrote it down because she has an unusual name, Gugu Mbatha-Raw is her name. And she's terrific and she's absolutely adorable. But
Star Wars.
But he meets her and she's so gorgeous, she would never give him the time of day. But of course, in the end, not only do they become friends, she gives him a makeover, she buys him new clothes and cuts his hair and cleans up his apartment. These people would never be friends in real life, but she belongs to a biker gang. Oh, but not any biker gang, a motor scooter gang. Because that happens all the time. Every time I go to community college, I meet hot girls who want me to join their scooter gang. It happens all the time.
I knew a guy who saw the 2 minutes of the trailer, and he walked away with the idea the movie was about a retarded guy who has to wear a helmet all the time getting his first kiss. That was that was his takeaway of what Larry Crowne is about. So
yeah. The thing is that there is a certain Forrest Gumpiness to this guy, because again, you know, the Crowne is such this aw shucks guy, and he really does drift through this movie,
right,
an inch off the ground. Because he knows nothing bad will ever happen to him. It's like, in reality, so much bad stuff happens to this character, but the way it's presented, it's just not that bad.
Well, I think the thing is really important. I think that it's important that Tom Hanks, who really understands the everyman, who understands people working at Walmart, because he's been there. No, he's not. No. And that's the thing, right? It's so weird. It's,
you
like,
know,
isn't that condescending as shit?
You know what? That's actually a great point, because one of the things I wondered as I was waiting for the film to begin is, here's a guy who is unbelievably wealthy,
right,
and either you remember what it was like to not have money enough to be able to present this material with some dignity,
right,
or you're just so out of touch that this is what you think America will respond to.
Well, it's that glamorization of being poor. It's like, well, these people are poor, but they have heart.
And
Would you say this in front of Colin Hanks last week?
No, but I did make fun of Dennis Dugan a lot, as
did
it
you?
Turns out. Yes.
Yeah.
You know, I remember there was a thing I had said, this is harkening back, about, but to play off your point, about the Russell Crowe film about the boy he plays the box, Cinderella Man.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember saying that the problem with Cinderella Man is that it spends $110 million to depict poverty.
Right.
And that just doesn't equate, that doesn't compute, you can't do that.
Right.
You know, because now it's just glossy poverty. It's fairy tale poverty.
It's really well shot poverty. It looks real nice.
Yeah, actually it does. So Larry Crowne, I'm going to have to give, because I'm a Scrooge this week, I have to give that a burn. That thing is very disappointing. You know what? And it's not just your normal burn. It's a sad burn. It's a disappointed burn. It's a burn where you think Tom Hanks' last film was so terrific, that thing you do, and here is something that just is, it's just stillborn. So that is a burn. So here we have, who we have, Dark Side of the Moon, whatever it's called.
Transformers
with Optimus Steve.
Can I say one thing about Transformers?
Yes.
I guess this is a spoiler technically.
Is it something good or bad?
Bad.
Okay, good. If it was good, I wouldn't let you say it.
It's about Transformers 3. there's a scene where we discover in the movie that the reason why we had the Apollo program was to go find robots on the moon. And there's a scene where Buzz Aldrin shows up. And the real Buzz Aldrin. And it's like, oh, Optimus Prime, I went to the moon to meet you guys. And it's like, fuck you. It is like the stuff that NASA did, it was superhuman in the commitment and the bravery. And then to have Buzz Aldrin show up and be like shaking the hand of a giant robot. I mean, like, the people who lived and died for this, it just diminishes everything that they did. It's so horrible. And this is why I'm a Neil Armstrong man. 100%.
You know,
I kneel over Buzz.
That's
every
actually
day.
A great point. That's actually a great point. And what's funny is that Buzz Aldrin has spent a lot of time, too much time, debunking all of these moonshot was faked
right.
idiots that here he is in a movie talking about how the moonshot was like something else.
Right.
You know, so it, even on that level, it doesn't work. Yes, Corey.
Fucking Buzz Aldrin
was played by Bryan Cranston, who was in Larry Crowne in From the Earth to the Moon.
Ooh, interesting.
I'm just putting it all
That's
together.
Spooky. Wow.
Yes. And Buzz Aldrin also played himself in an episode of The Simpsons.
That has nothing to do with anything.
Yes, but I happen to remember it, so I'm putting it out there.
And Neil Armstrong punched a dude in the face for saying that the moon landing was fake. See, that I respect.
That's cool.
That I respect.
That's
like,
super cool.
Shaking the hand of Optimus Prime is like pretty fucking weak. Was that Buzz?
I think that was Buzz.
I think that was Neil.
Oh, someone, IMDb that.
Somebody also said the Star Trek guy was in a Transformers cartoon.
Leonard Nimoy. He was in Transformers the movie.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I can't handle it.
All right, so
So was Orson Welles.
Yeah, and true. You guys must be doing a good job because Deborah Oliver has donated $25 to during this show. So there you go. Suddenly it's become a telethon.
That is
You'll
Devin
never
related.
Walk
that's,
alone.
That's what? Devin related because Devin's here. People are giving us the money. Look at that. Yeah. You get none of it, by the way.
I know.
All right.
Moving okay, on. I'm Italian. I'm very good at getting money out of people.
So Transformers is a burn. Larry Crowne is a burn. And that's this weekend in movies. Whoa. All right, in a few minutes we have Rodman Flender coming on, director of the great documentary Conan O'Brien Can't Stop.
And we do mean a few minutes as opposed to last episode, which is 2.5 hours.
The worst. By the way, can I say
something?
But Colin
Hanks was awesome. It was a great interview, but leading up to that took forever.
Let me tell you something. So Devin shows up, and the first thing he says is this going to be 2.5 hours like last week? Right? And then
I got stuff to do.
And then Rodman, Devin never met. Rodman walks in and says, "This bullshit gonna be 2.5 hours?"
I didn't say bullshit.
I had a bullshit for effect. I admit it.
I think he called it this mummery.
This is claptrap. All right, so by the way, the answer is no. All right, let's do the news. Let's do it. Oh, Chad.
Hey, guys. I'm sorry I couldn't make it live this week. My apartment is being fumigated for vermin, and I'm not supposed to be in it. I had to come back here to pre-record the news. I probably shouldn't be here. Fumes are making me kind of dizzy, but anyway, I'm ready to do the news.
Do the news, Chad.
Anne Hathaway will be playing Catwoman in the next installment of the Batman franchise, The Dark Knight Rises. The gossip site Hollywood Life has pictures of her new costume. Word pictures. Meaning they don't have pictures at all. They describe the costume with words. See how I fooled you there? Bet you got really excited. Well, don't. They describe the costume in the vaguest, most uninteresting terms possible, saying that it will feature goggles and will be less sexy than Michelle Pfeiffer. I can't think of anything that stimulates my imagination less. They may as well have said, the costume features a belt and will be made of atoms.
You know what? Here's the thing is that, you know, Christopher Nolan has such integrity that he's going to put a gorgeous girl, Anne Hathaway, who I would love to see in anything, I don't care what she's wearing, I just want to look at her, in whatever serves the character. He's not going to make it purposely campy like Tim Burton did.
What it sounds like is, not only am I a Star Trek nerd, I'm a comic book nerd too, which is why I'm so popular with women. And what they're doing is it sounds like they're basing it on the latest design of the Catwoman costume, which was done about 2000, 2001. This artist, Darwin Cook, was doing the book with this writer, Ed Brubaker, and they sort of redesigned Catwoman tonally and look-wise. So she's got a tight leather outfit that looks sort of like maybe a real cat burglar would wear if they were like a super sexy fetish cat burglar. And then she's got these big goggles that are like, you know, night vision and stuff
like
that.
I've heard the goggles, Chad didn't say this, but I've heard that the goggles are part of the costume.
The goggles are supposed to be part of the costume. So I think they're going with the Darwin Cook look, which is a great design. And in the comic book world, characters like this, they get redesigned all the time. And this design is stuck for about 10 years now. So it really feels like this is sort of the modern age interpretation of Catwoman they're going with, which like for the nerds is a pretty big deal.
You know, actually, you've probably met her in Junkets, whatever. I saw her at a party, you know, and it was unbelievable. I just like, first of all, she's got...
You're making me like a junket whore over here,
she's
by
got,
the way.
To our audience, being like going to Junkets is like the most glamorous thing in the world.
You
got to own
met
it.
Her at Junkets.
You got to own it. You got to own it, man.
Okay.
People want to be.
What kind of party would you
people
meet
want to live? People want to live vicariously through us.
Which by the way, it's
pathetic.
Was it a sexy party?
It was in. It was a fetish party.
Was it a fetish party?
No, you know what? It was a Fox Searchlight party at the end of the year, and she was there, and she's gorgeous with very very doll like jewel like tiny features, and a bunch of other celebrities there too. But she's gorgeous.
She's smart.
You know what?
She's for a woman, yeah.
You know what?
First,
look.
I was offended.
For a skirt, she knows what's
I
going
know
on.
For a dame. I know. That's this is like an anti-Amy show. We had Amy on last week. Like,
by the way,
two times ago, it was all
before,
very feminist.
Before we go on to Chad's next story, I do have to, in all seriousness, agree. Like, I was a little late to the Anne Hathaway career bandwagon. I don't know if I saw her first couple films, but she's really, you can tell, she's a smart actor. You know, and that's why, as I've seen her go on, I'm like, she's a smart actor. Right. She's no. This is not bullshit time.
Well, you can see things going on in her head when she's acting, which is so rare in actors of either gender. I mean, like, you can watch her and there is actually movement behind the eyes. It's kind of nice. And then you talk to her in real life and she's smart and funny, and then she's beautiful, which is like so unfair.
Yeah, I don't care about the rest of it. I just care about the beauty.
Wow.
What? That's worth $25 a Kickstarter.
I can't believe you're single. Hard to believe.
He says it every week.
Yeah.
Every week he says that.
Yeah.
And by the way, every week he's right. All right, Chad, what's next?
The trailer for the latest Mission Impossible film, Ghost Protocol, is out. Let's roll that trailer.
An hour ago, a bomb blew up the Kremlin. The president has initiated Ghost Protocol. The entire IMF has been disavowed. Now I've been ordered to take you to Washington, where they will hang the Kremlin bombing on you and your team, unless you were to escape after assaulting Brandt and me. But if any one of your team is caught, they will be branded terrorists out to incite global nuclear war.
What happens now?
Your mission, should you choose to accept it,
so what's the play?
Red?
Dead.
You're not gonna make it!
You're not helping.
What the hell was that? What the hell was that? I watched that entire trailer and did not see one ghost. When a movie is called Ghost Protocol, you can bet your boots that I want some ghosts. Spooky ghosts flying around, saying boo, observing protocol. This is one movie I am going to skip at the box office. Tom Cruise can suck it.
I don't know. Are you looking forward to this movie?
Yeah, it's Brad Bird, the animation guy who did a bunch of Pixar, The Incredibles, and Ratatouille, and he did Iron Giant, and this is his first live-action picture. I'm pretty excited.
I'm kind of on board, too. At first, I wasn't. You know, certain movies, you're like, do I need this? Does the culture need this? And then you're like, that Cars 2, does the culture need Cars? As a species, do we need Cars 2?
Right.
Not really. you know, as a species, do we need, like, you know what? I thought that about Captain America. I'm going very, as we digress, I'm going very up and down.
Right.
Do I need Captain America?
We need Captain America. Now more than ever.
I kind of feel like I'm on board.
Yeah.
It took a while. Yeah. I'm on board.
I'm not sure we need Mission Impossible Ghost Protocol, but I think it's all right. I mean, I'm interested. If it works, it works. I'm always curious to see how Tom Cruise is going to creep us out next. In the publicity phase, it's very exciting. So, and then also this one I think is like more team oriented. So, like, all the rest of the Impossible Mission Force team gets stuff to do. So, I think like Simon Pegg actually has things to do in this movie.
Well, I would imagine that they're going to probably try to hand it off to
Jeremy Renner.
Jeremy Renner.
Who is playing every single government operative he can play. He's a government operative in Mission Impossible Ghost Protocol. He's the new Bourne in the new Bourne series. And his character in the Avengers, Hawkeye, is a government operative for S.H.I.E.L.D. who uses a bow and arrow instead of a gun. So he's got three different government operative franchise things going on.
Typecasting, huh?
And then the Hurt Locker. Yeah, he's just like...
He is cool, though.
He's
although in Thor, he showed up for 4 seconds. He didn't have any, barely
that
any
was the
dialogue.
Worst thing I've ever seen in my whole life.
It Thor was like, or just his part of Thor?
I don't like Thor, but his part in Thor, it's like there's an action scene, and then it's like they cut to a different movie. It's like all of a sudden there's a different movie with Jeremy Renner in it that doesn't make any sense and has no bearing, and then he stands on a cherry picker and has a bow and arrow and then doesn't do anything. It's like so shockingly inept.
Yes. Well, I felt like it was that here's the sequence where we introduce the audience to this guy who will spin off in 3 years.
But I wish they could have figured out a way to do it that actually made some sort of moderate narrative sense.
Because the thing is that, and then we'll move on, but the thing is that if Hawkeye were to actually take a shot, and there's some amazing shot from 500 yards, and he pierces a bird in the eye from 500 yards, you'd be like, wow, I want to see a movie about that guy.
That sets up the guy, right. You know? But no, this is a guy who doesn't take a shot at anything.
That is true. All right, Chad, what do you got?
According to a recent interview in Sports Illustrated, Charlie Sheen admits to using steroids during the filming of Major League. He stopped using them after he found he could no longer control his temper. Apparently, he nearly beat up several strangers who mocked his haircut. Sorry, guys. I think I'm feeling a little lazy today, and I'm going to phone this one in. Just a sec. Hey, Chad here, phoning it in. Charlie Sheen does drugs. I suppose he also breathes oxygen and he exists in three-dimensional space. Boy, that Charlie Sheen sure is crazy. Am I right? Maybe he should date Lady Gaga. Who's with me? Blah, 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 winning tiger blood. Okay, gotta go. Bye. That was me phoning it in. I'm sorry.
Oh, Charlie. You know what? When Wade Major was hosting the show, you know, Wade had gone to school with Charlie. And so every opportunity he got, he used to sort of talk about Charlie right. And how screwed up he was, and X, Y, and Z. We used to talk about his problems. Now I'm sort of glad that Charlie has just pretty much crawled back into whatever rock he's now living in and desperately trying to get a career again. You know, does it surprise you that he would take steroids to do Major League? Not really. It doesn't even matter.
Who cares?
Yeah.
It's this crushing sense of who gives a shit about Charlie Sheen. Right? Isn't that like the thing? Like when he dies, won't even like Ryan Dunn's death have been a bigger shock? Do you know what I mean? Like when the guy from Jackass dies, you're more shocked than when Charlie Sheen's
dead. The problem is that Charlie Sheen isn't dead yet. You really thought it would have happened by now.
That is a problem. That is a really big problem, I would agree.
Did you not think he'd just be dead by now? Just be like the total flame? Or Lindsay Lohan, they'd just be dead and that'd be it? The trajectory? Like, when there was a moment...
No, Hollywood celebrities no longer have the good sense and decency to die. And it's this situation where they're all taken care of and they can do all these drugs and whatever and they have doctors to take care of them. And then so what happens is they just sort of burn out and become depressing husks. If Lindsay Lohan had died when she was 19, she'd be the new Marilyn Monroe. We'd like, you know, people would be like talking about her and having tattoos of her. But now she's made it long enough that nobody's going to give a shit when she finally goes. And, you know, if I was a famous person, I would have already been dead by now.
Well, may you never be famous.
I know.
And by the way, you know...
That's why I've steadily avoided becoming famous.
I think the last performer to do that was Chris Farley. When you started reading about Chris Farley
right.
and all of his coke, binging, whatever, you were like, man, this guy is going to be dead in 6 weeks. And man, that guy died in 6 weeks.
Well, that's the thing. He went out on top. I mean, we all thought Horatio Sands would be the next dead guy from
Saturday
Night Live.
But no,
he never went. Right. That's the thing. A fat guy in Saturday Night Live. He never went.
It's a kiss of death. All right, Chad, anything else? Chad, saying goodbye. Hello,
okay,
what are you
guys,
doing?
See you later. Boy, these fumes are making me dizzy. Oh, and you viewers... Don't forget about the Streaming Garage's Kickstarter campaign. Go to the website on your screen and contribute so that the Streaming Garage can pay their crew and continue to make great shows like Stupid for Movies. And there's a lot of fun rewards you can get for contributing, including a special Chad Vader prize package. The campaign ends August 1st. Go on there and give us your money. I want to get paid.
By the way, Chad mentions that the website was on the screen, and it was not. It's Kickstarter.com. Right, Mike?
Slash Streaming Garage.
Yeah, Kickstarter.com. Not even slash. Kickstarter.com, Streaming Garage. We've talked about it a lot. And there is a Chad Vader special package. He will leave you a special video, a video of thanks specifically to you, and then he's got four DVDs that that will be part of the package as well. So there's a Chad Vader package reward as well.
All right, so we're about halfway done with the show.
No.
Oh, not? Okay, I'm sorry. I'm still flashing back to, it's like a post-traumatic stress from last week's three-hour show. Although Rodman Flender, who'll be here in a few minutes, he liked it. So maybe we'll do it again. Rodman Flender. Conan O'Brien can't stop. All right, now it's time for instant gratification, cutting the cord. The segment's so nice, we named it twice. All right, so here's how it works. Now, Devin Faraci from BadassDigest.com, that's this guy, in case you, as opposed to being the guy in the middle, of which there is none, unless you're stoned. We are each going to recommend two films that you can stream online. No more renting DVDs, no more going to Redbox. That's yesterday's news. It's all about streaming. Do you have Netflix?
I do.
What was the last thing you streamed on Netflix? Go.
The Right Stuff.
Ooh, The Right Stuff. Yeah, classic. I saw a special screening of The Right Stuff with Deschanel was there. And of course, Kaufman never there.
Right.
The whole cast was there. It was such a thrill to see those guys. You know, it's such a great movie. Mike's giving me the move along.
I don't want this to go 2 hours.
You know what?
See, you complain, and then I try to speed the show up, and then you're like, I want to slow it down.
Fine.
Now, whose fault is it?
Mine.
And now look how much time we've just taken doing this.
I admit it. It's my fault. All right. My first recommendation is available on Crackle, which is at crackle.com. It's The Squid and the Whale from 2005. This is directed by Noah Baumbach. And Noah Baumbach, of course, also directed Margaret with the Wedding and Greenberg. And in the film, this is the story of two boys who take very different paths as they react to the divorce of their parents in 1980s Brooklyn. And obviously you can tell that this is a story that meant a lot to Noah Baumbach. And in the movie, Jesse Eisenberg, who went on to be Oscar nominated for The Social Network, Jesse Eisenberg plays a 14-year-old kid who, as the parents get divorced, he starts to sort of side with the father, this sort of a burned-out, bitter novelist, played by Jeff Daniels in a great performance. The 10-year-old son winds up siding with the mother, played by Laura Linney. And what I liked about this film a lot is that even though it is light on the outside, it is definitely dark on the inside. You know, a lot of people have problems with Baumbach. They feel that he's very sort of twee, and he's got that sort of, you know, New Yorker sensibility that people kind of really don't like. I think the guy's terrific, and he's never been better than here. This is an Oscar-nominated screenplay, and I liked it a lot because the battle lines are clearly drawn. The characters are rich and interesting. The boys all sort of go their separate ways based on the parent that they attach themselves to the best, and everybody has their arc. All the characters are interconnected. It feels, as somebody whose parents divorced in the, my parents divorced in the late 70s, but it's the same thing. You really feel like he's been there. He's writing from a place of strength. And that's why I like the movie a lot. You feel it, and you know that he's went through this. And all the performances are great. Jeff Daniels is terrific. Jesse Eisenberg, an actor who I really don't like all that much, although I liked him a lot in Social Network, and I liked him in Roger Dodger, but in between those, the kid kind of annoys me. He's good in this. The movie's actually pretty short. I think it's like less than 90 minutes. So he really gets in and out great. Great locations in Brooklyn. I think the film is just very rich and very real, and I liked it a lot.
I love Squid and the Whale. I also, I don't want to save my sob story, but as a child of divorce also, it really rings true. There's the scene where Eisenberg tries to pass off a Pink Floyd song as his own song, and that's something that really I remember doing in high school. And it's that sort of trying really hard to be intellectual thing that's really great. And I think that Baumbach is really great because in this film he appreciates the idea of being intellectual while also sort of puncturing the buffoonish intellectual thing. And it's just really funny.
It's honest and it's raw and it's really, really funny. Any movie that has a young kid smearing semen on lockers, I think, is probably...
You're on board.
I'm on board. A plus.
Yeah. You know, but you bring up a good point about the Pink Floyd, because that's what's so great about the film, because each of the boys, they take a certain aspect, negative aspect of their parents, and they sort of ingest it and bring it out in their own way, because they're kids. And, right. You know, when you're that young, you know, your parents are invincible, they know everything, but then they get divorced and you start to see the cracks, and then divisions start to grow, you know, and I think he really gets that down.
Yeah, I mean, it's one of the better depictions of sort of how the shrapnel of this exploding marriage, and, you know, it gets itself stuck into these kids and how it really screws them up. But it is dark and it is raw, but it's also sweet in a non-saccharine way, which I like. It was one of my favorite movies of that year. I really love Squid and the Whale.
I agree, and it's available to stream on Crackle.
Crackle.com.
Now, Devin, you want to recommend?
Which is first? I'm going to do The Manitou first, which is not quite as intellectual as The Squid and the Whale. The Manitou is this really insane movie starring Tony Curtis, directed by the late William Girdler, and it's a movie where Tony Curtis is a sham psychic who gets called in when Susan Strasberg has a lump on the back of her neck that turns out, as I think a lot of us have had this happen to us, contains an evil midget medicine man. And so this evil midget medicine man begins growing out of her neck, and Tony Curtis, who's like her ex, gets called in to sort of help. And it's just one of these really insane movies where it's based on a novel and you don't really understand why anybody made this into a movie, but you're so glad they did because it's just so nuts, and it ends up in her hospital room, at the end of the movie, turns into space, and she's in the bed topless shooting laser beams out of her hands.
I love that scene!
At a midget.
That's a great scene!
At a slimy midget. He looks like a little tiny Danzig. It's unreal. It's so great. It's so nuts. And it's so nuts in this really specific sort of 70s way where it has these convictions. It thinks it's about stuff. It thinks it's about like Native American issues and stuff like that. And it's not, because all the Native Americans are all played by white people. It's so crazy. I love it so much. I can watch it again and again and again. It's terrible. It's delightful. And it's on Netflix, where you should be watching it streaming. Turn this shit off and go watch that. After you go to Kickstarter.com.
Yes, that's now all he's right, talking. I you know what? I don't know that I love Manitou. I think you're right. It's a terrible film. But I remember the scene where she's on the bed naked in space shooting lasers out of her hands, and it was the best.
It's so crazy.
It was the best. And you're like, I don't know what this is, but this girl's hot, and she's naked on a bed. She's doing what like a comic book hero would do, so now I'm totally turned on.
I love it. The movie opens up with Tony Curtis as this fake psychic, and he's wearing like a wizard robe and a big wizard hat and a fake beard. It's so good.
But
he's totally Tony Curtis, because the evil spirit is called Miskamakus, and he calls him Mixmaster. Literally calls him Mixmaster again and again and again.
And you know that's not in the script.
That's just Tony Curtis just doing Tony Curtis.
He couldn't pronounce. He's like, I had to call him Mixmaster.
Oh, it's so good. Oh, man.
And Tony Curtis really isn't. He really isn't like a whole other movie.
It's a terrific little movie. Everybody's in a different movie from everybody else. It's one of these really special sci-fi movies that just never should have been made, but we're all so lucky that it was.
God. You know what? I cannot agree more. The Manitou. My next recommendation is on Netflix. It is a 1994 all-time classic, Double Indemnity, directed by probably the best director of all time, Billy Wilder. Right. Best director of all time. Go. You're wrong. It's Billy Wilder. Go. Oh, I'm giving you a second chance at it.
Yeah, give him a second chance.
The best director of all time?
Yes.
Oh, Michael Bay.
Wrong, Billy Wilder.
Michael Bay.
Written by Wilder and Raymond Chandler. Raymond Chandler, of course, the famous novelist who is an alcoholic, and the two of them famously never got along. The movie's actually based on a book by James M. Cain, who also wrote The Postman Always Rings Twice. And Frederick Murray is an insurance salesman. Barbara Stanwyck is a woman who wants her husband dead. The two of them get together, and they plot to maybe murder the husband. And if it seems like an accident, then a double indemnity clause pays out double the money. And that is basically the film. It is quintessential noir. It is really, really well shot. It's grubby set. You know, the set design was so good. And Wilder, he was a smart guy. I loved him. What they would do is they would prepare the set for the scene. And then right before they shot, Wilder would walk around the set overturning ashtrays and books and papers just to make the room seem a little more lived in. I mean, that's how much he had attention to detail, and that's how character-rich this guy was. You know, I'm not a big fan of Fred McMurray, and yet he's the perfect guy for this role because he has to be just a little bit of a schlub, because he's got to be taken in by Barbara Stanwyck's charms. And for Barbara Stanwyck, this was an unusual film for her because she had never really done a role like this. And she decided to do it, and thank God she did it because she's great in it. You know, there's some interesting backstory to the film where the film was maybe going to be made about 10 years earlier, but the Hayes office said there's no way you can make this film. About 9 or 10 years later, Paramount says, screw you, we're making it anyway. And even though there was some back and forth with the Hayes office and the production code, they did wind up getting it made, and it's just great. I love Double Indemnity. It's one of my all-time favorite movies.
It's not just, it's one of the quintessential noir films. It's sort of one of the touchstone movies in the noir genre, and it's a great film. I mean, Billy Wilder's so amazing because what I love about Billy Wilder is that English wasn't even his first language, and he's one of the best screenwriters who ever lived. His turn of phrase, the way that he uses language, is not even his native language, and he's beating everybody else in the business, you know, in the years since. And Fred McMurray, I think people who only know him from his goofy sitcom stuff will be really surprised. I think what Wilder knows how to get great stuff. Adam McMurray, I think it's a beautiful film. It looks gorgeous, it's not. My favorite Wilder is the funny Wilder, the sort of acerbic, mean, funny Wilder, but Double Indemnity, you can't go wrong with that.
You know, it's funny, you talk about two things about Wilder and the language. You know, what just came out on Criterion this week is People on Sunday. Now, People on Sunday is a silent film that he wrote.
Right.
You know, we're talking the 30s now. You know, and People on Sunday is a terrific film before he came to the States, and that's a great film. And in this film, you know, his writing partner at the time, this is before I.A.L. Diamond, his writing partner at the time was Charles Brackett. And Brackett didn't want to write this film. Brackett felt like Double Indemnity was not really in his wheelhouse. It was very dark. So Brackett kind of jumped off it, and they wound up with Raymond Chandler. And Raymond Chandler was actually the one. It was funny because Wilder, and then we'll move on, Wilder wanted to maintain as much of the dialogue from the original book as possible. And Chandler, to his credit, said, no, the dialogue in the book is not movie dialogue. And what they did was they did something smart, which is they actually typed out all the dialogue from the book, and they brought in an actor and an actress to act it out. You know, and when they acted it out, Wilder said, you know what? You're right. This is book dialogue. So they went back and they rewrote all the dialogue. And it was so smart, and it's such a great film, and I just love Double Indemnity. Great. So that is on Netflix. Now, Devin has one more.
Yeah, I think it's really, we go from one of the greatest movies of all time to Zardoz, a movie starring Sean Connery in a red diaper. It's sort of a, there's sort of a theme here with my picks. Zardoz is like the Manitou, a 1970s science fiction movie that never should have been made. It's totally batshit insane. John Borman, who's a really great director, lost his mind in every possible way when he's making Zardoz, a movie that opens up with a giant floating head spitting guns at a bunch of half-naked men, telling them that the penis is bad and the gun is good. And Sean Connery is this brute who ends up in this, it's this dystopian future world. He ends up with these higher class people on the other side of the mountain. It's weird. It doesn't make a lot of sense. And it has the world's best reveal of what the title of the movie means. It is a totally bonkers reveal. And I don't want to spoil it because everybody should go see it. The Manitou is really terrible, like in a really fun way. The Manitou is a kind of you can watch and really enjoy. Zardoz is not quite as fun as the Manitou, but it's a movie that's so weird and so singular that I feel like everybody should see it. And the beauty of streaming stuff is you don't have to go to the theater or go rent it. It's just right there on your TV. And you know what? You're sitting on your couch, you lazy ass, watch Zardoz. and you know what? Again, it's Sean Connery in a red diaper, bandoliers, and like a porn star mustache, and he's got a ponytail. It's totally crazy. This was the same time that John Borman was going to do a really weird Lord of the Rings movie.
Yes, back in the 70s. This was
everything was so fucked up. It was so good back then.
Well, this is what Borman did after Deliverance. I mean,
right.
Deliverance.
He took his Deliverance
cachet and he traded it in
for the weirdest, shittiest science fiction movie imaginable.
And you know. Here's the thing with Zardoz, in my opinion. It's got a lot of big ideas.
Right.
But somehow, all those big ideas get lost in just the craziness of this movie. You know, there's a lot of great special effects. It was shot by Jeffrey Unsworth, who also shot 2001. So it looks great, and there's a lot of great effects in it, and there's a lot of great ideas in it. It's just a little too bonkers
right.
to really put it all together into one film.
But that's what makes it a really delightful cult movie. It's sort of like Lynch's Dune in that way, which is that it's a movie that when you watch it as a film, boy, this is not a very good movie. But all these weird elements on their own are just so beautiful and so fascinating and so wonderful. And there's a certain point where you just have to sit back and go, they got this one past everybody. Like, it doesn't make any sense, and they got it past everybody.
And you can't do that now? You can't get that past everybody now?
You can. It's sad. We're never going to see Daniel Craig in a big red diaper with bandoliers, if only.
If only. I live to see that day. All right, so here's the thing. We have the instant gratification. So I said Squid and the Whale and Double Indemnity. Devin, really showing his tastes here on the show, gives us Zardoz and the Manitou. So now you get a sense of where Devin's coming from. He loves the crazy cult stuff.
The weirder, the better. Yeah.
And I love that. That stuff's great. So that's instant gratification, folks.
Now.
No, it's not.
It seems like it.
All right, here's the thing. We have a very special guest. Now, yes. You know, Mike Rotman and I, producer Mike, the guy with the beard.
Wait, there's a guy with the beard there, too.
Huh?
The other guy.
Is your name Mike Rotman?
No.
There's discussions of who has a better beard, actually.
Well, he's the guy with the more trimmed beard. Mine is just like sort of like...
Do you ever clean that up? Do you go to like a wedding or like
no,
a bar mitzvah or something?
I do clean it up, but right now I have my 70s bush beard is what I'm doing.
Because it's Zardoz.
So. Well, it's the valley, so...
Mike and I met years ago when we were both working on an NBC late night talk show called Later with Greg Kinnear. Mm-hmm. Now, Later with Greg Kinnear lasted for about 2-3 years, whatever it was.
I left after... No, I think it was like 4 years. I left after like...
I stayed on the show after Greg left to pursue films.
I went to Politically Incorrect with Bill Maher.
Don't name drop. Okay, so here's the thing. There was a moment there when our show was being primed to take over for Late Night with Conan O'Brien, which had stumbled out of the gate at the beginning. In fact, I remember they had brought in a very nice guy, whose name I won't mention because he may not want to be mentioned, a really nice guy to actually oversee the transition. And I remember, and Mike might remember this, they bring this guy in and he winds up taking over the office of the then executive producer. So when they bring in the big New York guy and throw you out of your office so he can take over, that creates a lot of agita and what is going on and what's happening
and
are people being fired.
I was a writer assistant at the time. He brought me in to tell me I was going to become a writer once we went to 1230.
And that's
so I actually had the go ahead.
That's why we didn't go to 1230 because who wants to see Mike Wright?
Yeah. No. Well, then I went to Politically Incorrect where I wrote.
And he was Oscar nominated.
Emmy.
Okay.
Take an Oscar.
Exactly. So anyway, so obviously that didn't happen. Greg went on to a movie career starting with Sabrina. And Conan has obviously continued and thrived.
And I'll say the same thing I said when we were supposed to take over, when I was brought into that meeting. I said, but Conan has the best writing staff. They're insane if they replace us with Conan.
You didn't say
no,
that.
No, I did. I actually said that. I totally said that.
No, you didn't.
I did.
Why would you say that?
Because Conan was great.
So you're going to screw yourself out of a job by saying, don't hire me.
They're not going to listen to me. But at the time, I could not believe that NBC was even considering that because Conan had the most brilliant writing staff, without a doubt.
All right,
and I thought NBC was crazy to even consider it.
Okay, stop that.
Done.
It's not true. Okay, so Conan, brilliant, continue to be brilliant until the NBC Tonight Show debacle, which we'll talk about in a second, with Rodman Flender, who directed an excellent documentary called Conan O'Brien Can't Stop, which Devin saw, and you liked it, right?
Saw it at South by, I loved it.
And so we have Rodman standing by. Let's take a look at the trailer and a clip, and then we'll bring Rodman on.
In improvisational acting, there's this great rule that I've used in my life, which is act as if. Act as if this is completely normal.
Call me Conan, please.
Of course I'm supposed to be interviewing Barack Obama, or of course I'm supposed to be playing guitar with Bruce Springsteen. And of course there's a big part of you inside that's saying, what are you talking about? This doesn't feel completely real. It doesn't feel completely real to me. This is just an extension of replacing David Letterman at the age of 30.
How's that first show gonna go? What do you think, Sona?
I think it's gonna go really well.
I just saw a sign that said Sheboygan, Wisconsin.
Sheboygan? I kill him in Sheboygan.
Let's push this crowd back. I need room here. Everyone give me some room. Get these people back. I want everyone back. No. No photos.
All right, Rodman Flender, everybody.
Hello.
Yeah. Look at that.
Thank you.
Here's your movie.
Well, thank you. I'm so relieved, actually, that you both liked the movie, because if you said it was one of your stinkers, this would be very awkward for me.
We are very desperate for guests right now.
Oh, is that
so,
it?
So, you know, I'm willing to say anything.
So if Dennis Dugan was out in the parking lot, you'd bring him in? And
you know, someday Dennis Dugan is gonna really just, he's going to slash my tires. I didn't really mean it, but I meant it. He's a terrible director. Say something.
You know what I can say about Dennis Dugan? I actually haven't seen his movies. So
you're a smart man.
Say. But you know what? Wait, did Dennis Dugan go to college with Adam Sandler?
Wait, did Dennis Dugan go to college? I would stop there.
Did he?
Quite frankly, I have no idea.
Was he a college buddy of Adam Sandler's? Because I went to college with Conan O'Brien, and there was a point on the bus where someone was talking about a director who I think had directed an Adam Sandler movie, and he had gone to college with Adam Sandler, and so what kind of lame director needs to get a job from this college buddy? My God, and everyone laughed, and there was kind of this awkward pause where it's like, oh, sorry.
Dugan is 64 years old.
So I guess he didn't go to college with Adam Sandler.
So hang on. So now you're saying that you went to college with Conan.
I did, yes.
So how does that happen? Hello, my name is Rodman. My name is Conan. How does that come together? What happened there?
Exactly like that.
Really?
You know
the
what?
The quad?
The yard. The quad? Come on. Harvard Yard. Conan and I were both on the Harvard Lampoon. And I had, I'm a year older than Conan, and I had heard about this guy. There was already a buzz about Conan as undergraduates, this very tall, really hysterically funny freshman named Conan O'Brien. And so his even as a college freshman, his reputation preceded him. And we met on the Lampoon, and there we are. We were wacky college undergraduates together.
Did you guys stay in touch over the years? Did you get back in touch again when the idea for the documentary came up?
We did stay in touch over the years, and I had he had come out to LA first, and then I came out to LA, and then he went back to New York to do the late night show, and I stayed here. So we sort of bounced around the country, but we did remain friends, you know, over long distance.
Well, it's interesting because I mean, I didn't know that you guys had gone to college together, but one of the things that's most interesting about the film is how raw inside him it is, and not in the Robin Bird way, but in the psychological way, which is that it really feels like he's very comfortable having you there. I mean, obviously he's opening up in a way that he probably couldn't have opened up to somebody else.
Yeah, the Robin Bird reference is the old Channel J from Manhattan for I was making an analogy between them. But yeah, I mean, I was also a one-man crew for about 80% of the shoot. It was just me with a camera, which is very difficult. There's a lot of anxiety because the pressure's all on me. You know, I'm the only one there who's responsible to get it. But the advantage is, I think it can lend to some of the intimacy that I hope you see in the movie that might not have been there had there been a bigger crew with extra cameras and boom microphones and all that good stuff I didn't get.
Did you find that, because you were sort of so invisible comparative to other documentary crews, that he would forget there was a camera there? Or is there always that little performer gene in him where he knows that you're there? Did you ever feel like he was letting go completely?
The Conan that you see in the movie is Conan O'Brien. I mean, he's always, whether he's in a cab and it's completely dark, I mean, he's just a naturally funny guy, and that's how his mind works, and that's just the way he looks at the world, and these kind of weird analogies and Civil War references, and it's just nonstop in his head that way. So that's what you see, and it's funny. We did the DVD commentary last week, and I posed it, and it was my dream group, because it was, if you've seen the movie, it was me, Conan, obviously, Andy joined us, Mike Sweeney, who's Conan's head writer, if you know Mike, and who's very funny. He says very little in the movie, but what he says is always very funny, and Sona, who's Conan's assistant, who you know, I think is kind of the breakout star of the movie.
She's cute.
And she is. So we're all in the room together.
Oh, love connection. What's happening there?
Go. No, my girlfriend would be very upset about that.
You know, I'm not telling tales out of school. We were at a Conan and I did a Q&A at the theater last weekend, and she was there. He asked her if she was single, yes, she's single.
Well,
so
if I was single, I would be all over that.
Right. So where was I? So okay, so we're doing the Q&A, and I asked them, you know, did my presence, you know, change the dynamic of the room at all? And I think Andy Richter honestly said, maybe for about 2 minutes. And then Mike Sweeney said, you know what, it's kind of like a bad smell. After a few minutes, you just kind of get used to it. Like, you know it's there, but then you just sort of, it's just part of the air. And you just, so I was a bad smell in the room. I was just part of the air.
I mean, because there is a difference between a documentary maker keeping distance and the advantages that that gives you versus the documentary maker who is very close to the subject and the advantages that that gives you.
Right.
You know, I mean, you've done both, because I know you've done a number of documentaries where you feel like, you know, you've got to get close to this person because that's where you'll get the truth versus having to step back because you want reality to happen in front of you. I mean, right. Was there ever a sense where you thought, I want to step back, I don't want to be his friend, I uh-huh. want to just let things happen?
Yeah, I did. I did want to remain objective. And actually, that was kind of a struggle because as his friend, it was hard to see him go through such a difficult time. But as a filmmaker, I wanted to completely detach and really let him be miserable and wallow as in front of the camera. So that was challenging. And that is actually, I had no agenda. I mean, that was kind of, those are sort of the documentaries that I'm interested in. The documentarians who I ape and want to, want to emulate are people like D.A. Pennebaker or the Maisels. And, you know, I guess Fred Wiseman is the ultimate documentary filmmaker like that. Kind of the opposite of Michael Moore, someone who's got an agenda, who has a message they want to teach you. I had no message. I had no agenda. I wasn't out to give Conan a platform. I wasn't out to deify him or do a Conan infomercial. And to his credit, when I pitched him the project of doing this movie, I said to him, I don't want to do a Conan O'Brien product. You know, the movie I referenced that I did not want to be like was U2 Rattle and Hum, which, and I love U2, but that movie kind of deifies them. You see, you know, shots of them in slow motion, walking like gods, and I did not want to do that to Conan. It was easy to do because there was a lot of, you know, support and grassroots support for him coming up at that time. But I was very interested to see his process and to see him put this live show together and to capture, you know, the nuts and bolts of how that show got made and how he used his comedy to process and work through these very difficult feelings he was going through at the time.
There's this really interesting scene. I was at the show at Universal City when
the Gibson
with
Jim Carrey.
Yeah, and so there's all this behind the scenes stuff there where he's really exhausted and he's being constantly forced to meet and greet, and because he's Conan O'Brien, he can't turn it off. He's always being on. And there's the I guess the tag to that scene is the Coquettes come in with their families or whatever, and mm-hmm. at the end Conan's like, "Can we not have this happen again?" Mm-hmm. Does he have input into the editing process of that? Because that's one of the parts where it's really human. But it's also one of those parts where it's like, when the Coquettes come to the screening, he's got to tell them, hey guys, I'm really sorry that I said this about you behind your backs. I mean, was he involved in any of that stuff at all?
You know, he wasn't. When the tour ended for them, the TBS show began for all of them. They started putting together the TBS show. And I kind of stayed on the tour because I edited all these hours of footage I had shot. So the movie kind of went off his radar, I think, while he was putting the TBS show together. And then, whatever it was, 6 months later, I had a cut of the movie together, and I wanted to show it to him, and he didn't really want to see it for obvious reasons. You know, it was a difficult time in his life, and he had moved on and was working on something new and had, you know, a new network and a network that supported him and appreciated him. And it was sort of a time travel for him to go back and kind of relive very emotionally this difficult time. So he was not really part of the editing. He wasn't part of the editing process at all. He looked at it, and actually the first cut of the movie that he saw, because we submitted, I wanted to, you know, submit to South by Southwest. I had these deadlines. The very first cut didn't have any of the concert footage in it, and the film, for those who haven't seen it, it kind of intercuts back and forth between the making of the show, and what happens backstage, and then illustrating what happens with sequences from the tour and sequences from the show. And the very first cut didn't have any of the show in it. I just wanted to get the bones of the documentary down. So the first cut that he saw was basically 90 minutes of him yelling at people. and that was difficult for him. I kind of had to tie him down. I say, like Malcolm McDowell on A Clockwork Orange, you know, pry his eyes open. And I said, you know what, let me cut the footage of the show in, and when people see what you're working towards and see the comedy and see the material and the product and what all this is about, I think it'll be a more even experience than just just you yelling at people and being upset and frustrated. So.
Well, is there, when you went into it, were you expecting one thing and then you got something else, or did you really go in there not knowing what you would get? Because you know Conan, mm-hmm. you know him emotionally, how he reacts to certain crises and triumphs in his life. When you went into it, did you think it's going to become this versus what it became, or were you pretty much just open to whatever it became?
All of the above. Here's what I knew. I knew that the funniest Conan O'Brien is not necessarily the Conan you see on TV every night. And I wanted to capture that. Because he's just a naturally funny guy and very sarcastic and kind of mean sometimes in a very funny way. And I wanted to expose that and share that with the world. I also wanted to capture the sort of what I call the Judy Garland, Mickey Rooney, hey, let's put on a show. Because there was an aspect of that to this show. They, as you can see in the movie, they sold out the show before they even knew what it was. So it came together very quickly. So there was, oh, let's get some wacky costumes, and, you know, what songs should we do? Let's get the band together, and let's get some backup singers. And I really want, you know, I'm a big fan of those movies and 42nd Street and, you know, backstage musicals. So I kind of wanted to make my own backstage musical in a way. And as I said earlier, I just wanted to capture how he was going to process this as it happened. It seemed like a great opportunity, you know, I knew it would have an end. I knew the tour was finite. So I knew I wasn't making a documentary about a strike in a factory that could go on and on, or, you know, a lot of documentaries. The last documentary I made took, I spent years cutting it, and I went back and I shot more 5 years later. I knew this couldn't be that. I liked the fact that it had an end to it. What surprised me was seeing just how addicted he is to applause and to the audience and to that laugh, and I thought that was very interesting to see that kind of performer's need, and it surprised me. This is no surprise to him. Early on in the movie, he says, "I'm like Tinkerbell. Without applause, I die." So he's well aware of that. But because I'd never worked with him before, I hadn't really seen that. So to me, even though that wasn't an intention going in, once I started cutting the film, That's sort of, I believe, one of the major themes that for me became apparent was a performer's need to connect with an audience.
Well, I mean, speaking of needs, your career path to here is an interesting one. I mean, from Munchies to Conan O'Brien Can't Stop is not an obvious through line.
Right.
Was documentary always the
thing? I didn't direct Munchies. That was Jim Wynorski. I was working for Roger Corman when that was made. I did the ad campaign, though, which was the famous Marilyn Monroe pose, and we had one of the Munchies under the grate looking up her skirt.
That was your idea?
That was my idea, and the MPAA rejected it. There was a woman, she's not there anymore, her name was Bethlyn Hand, and she had approval over every ad that had the MPAA bug on it, and she, you know, at first she rejected it, and I think we made some changes, and then she approved it. But so I was responsible for that lewd ad. I did direct Leprechaun 2.
You started in a very different world. Was documentary mm-hmm. always the end game, or was this sort of something you found yourself getting into?
I have no idea what the end game is. I where's the tote board? That's my end game. I want to get to what is it? 20,000? Where's the big board?
We're gonna have that.
Is that
thermometer?
Okay.
Yeah, we'll have we're gonna do a telethon. We'll do Good. A 24-hour big board, and Mark's gonna sing, and it's gonna be great.
I want that. I want us to be sitting here for 6 hours, and I want us all to be looking like Jerry Lewis with our
You are more than invited. Right, you are more than invited to the telethon if you'd like to come back.
Right. Okay. Yeah. That's
his next documentary.
Yes.
Oh, there you go.
It's a sequel to They Shoot Horses, Don't They?
Oh, Cindy Pollack.
Yeah.
Oh.
But great movie.
But Carmen, you were for... Okay, go ahead.
So Endgame. No, I actually, going back to Harvard, I studied documentary filmmaking with Ross McElwee, who made Sherman's March, among many other great movies. So that's kind of how I started. And then after I graduated, the legendary Roger Corman gave me an opportunity, and his list of graduates is greater than all the film schools combined, you know, from Francis Coppola to Jonathan Demme to
James
actors.
Cameron.
James Cameron, who did Piranha 2. For Roger, and actors like, you know, Jack Nicholson. Anyway, it goes on and on and on. So, of course, I leapt at that opportunity. He said, I was fresh out of college, and he said, do you have any experience in advertising? because that's where we have an opening. And I said, no, none. And he said, well, are you interested in the position? And I said, yes. And the following week, I was vice president in charge of worldwide marketing and distribution. That was it was 1 week later. And I had no idea. I was like, I had to, you know, negotiate. It was everything from cutting trailers and coming up with ads for things like Munchies and TV spots to actually negotiating with the individual newspapers, the ad buys. I mean, it was everything.
But that's very sink or swim. You either do it or you don't.
Oh, yeah,
and
definitely.
Obviously, you didn't sink.
He kept me around.
And how long did you work for him?
I worked for Roger for, let's see, I did that ad job for about a year. And then he left to direct his first movie in 15 or 20 years called Frankenstein Unbound,
yes.
Which you may have seen. And I was going to direct a movie, and then he got that gig. And he basically gave me the keys to the kingdom and said, here, you run the studio while I'm off in Europe shooting this movie. And I said, okay. And that was pretty crazy. I produced, I think, 12 movies in his absence. And then finally, when he came back, he let me direct a movie. And so I think it was like 3 or 4 years. That was my graduate work.
So you had green light power while he was in Europe doing Frankenstein Unbound?
I did, yeah.
So you greenlit what? What movie... we glad to have our video stores and Redbox kiosks?
You know what? There's a movie called Streets, directed by Kat Shea, that is a pretty gritty little movie that Christina Applegate was in, and I think it was her first dramatic role. She had only been doing the sitcom at that point and playing kind of a bimbo, and in this movie, it was a very gritty movie where she was a runaway, being stalked by a psycho cop. And she was terrific, and we really got to see that she had some acting chops. So I was very proud of that.
Yet Corman said, you greenlit that?
Right, exactly.
Where's Dino Shark?
Right. Yeah.
Did you use the same method that Roger did, which was, I guess, the title on a poster? Was that your method for greenlighting?
Well, no. I mean, Roger's formula was if you could somehow work the star of the movie into the title and the catch line of the movie, that is gold. And his prime example was Ron Howard pops the clutch and tells the world, eat my dust. So he got the star of the movie, the catch line, and the title, eat my dust. And eat my dust was one of his most successful movies. I mean, that was a huge hit for him.
So we can see the through line from that to Conan O'Brien Can't Stop.
Yeah.
We can see that right there. Getting the star's name in the title
right.
comes directly from Roger.
You're absolutely right.
Wow.
You know, you're absolutely right. And it does seem a little... strange that you may think there's a disconnect, doing a movie like Demon of Paradise and Stripped to Kill 2 to producing the movies to a documentary, but kind of the lessons I learned there were exactly the same, and that is you just keep going. You don't stop. There are, we couldn't throw money at problems when I was making movies for Roger Corman, and so similarly when I was doing this documentary about Conan at the beginning, I started shooting weeks after the whole Tonight Show thing blew up, because I knew it wasn't like a fiction film where if an actor drops out, you wait a week, or if you want to make script changes, you push. I wanted to capture him tweeting the announce of the tour to the world and capture whatever it was that was going to happen. And if you see the movie, people know, the tour sold out very quickly just with one tweet. You can't wait for stuff like that.
Right.
I had to be there while it was happening. So those were, those lessons I learned all those years ago were lessons I certainly took with me directing this Cinema Verite style. So
you see these guys on tour and they really wear down by the end, obviously. Mm-hmm. It's a long tour. How was it for you? I mean, you're not on stage performing, but was this exhausting and wearing on you as well, that length of that?
Yeah, it was. It was very tiring, especially because I said for most of it I was a one-man crew and
right.
a one-man band, so it all fell to me. People have asked me, "Oh, it must have been fun. It must have really been fun, on that tour and Eddie Vedder, and that must have really been fun." And no, it wasn't fun. I mean, there's an incredible Eddie in Seattle. Eddie Vedder came out and did Baba O'Reilly with the band, and it was amazing. Conan has gone on to say that it's like one of the best live musical performances he's ever heard, to hear Baba O'Reilly with that big horn section. Conan's band is fantastic. I was standing right in front of the speaker without any ear protection. So it was great, and I lost my hearing for 7 days. So it wasn't fun. My, this is fun. My fun is now. coming on Stupid for Movies and getting the tote board up and
Yeah.
Know.
I love it.
So but, this is my fun right now with you guys.
But yeah, but also, you know, you're also seeing your friend go through a certain amount of pain. And you're shooting it. Was there any sort of a push and pull, like, I want to help my friend, but yet I can't help my friend because I need to be shooting this?
There was. That was a challenge. I really did need to detach myself and remain objective. I mean, obviously, there were times when I would turn the camera off and we'd have a meal together and that sort of thing. But and also, he, I think, has a terrific support team around him. I mean, you really see in the movie. People like, you know, Andy, he's great on the show, but he's a good friend as well. So he wasn't, you know, I don't think I left him floundering out there. I didn't want to be Nick Broomfeld. You know, I didn't want to be, and although I admire those filmmakers and I certainly admire Michael Moore, I hate the sound of my own voice. I can't believe I'm yammering right now as much as I am because I can't stand the sound of my own voice. So I didn't want to be a presence in the movie at all. I wanted to pull my questions out as much as I could. I mean, we never did any formal interviews. The scenes you see where he's talking were just conversations.
And there's no narration.
In the car. Yeah, there's no narration. I licensed a Taiwanese cartoon at the beginning just to get the setup out of the way.
Well, that was smart.
Yeah.
Because you want to get that out of the way as quickly as you can because people already know it, but maybe if you need a 90-second refresh, there it is.
Right.
And that was a very smart way to do it, especially them, because obviously they're the hip Taiwanese animation house that does all the crazy, you know, topical little movies, you know?
Right.
And that was a very smart choice.
Although now, talk about meta, they've done one about the documentary.
Have they?
Yeah, and it's called Conan O'Brien's Beating a Dead Horse.
Wow.
And it's like, they haven't seen the movie because the movie has nothing to do with Jay Leno or NBC or The Tonight Show. It's all about his process and putting the show together. It has absolutely nothing to do with that. So that was surprising that they did
that.
Well,
you know, you're among friends right now.
Uh-oh.
And so there's a couple of bits where Conan will make a little Jay joke. Mm-hmm. But was there more? Did you cut stuff out where he's making angrier Jay jokes or NBC references just to be aware of his legal situation or...
No. Nobody's I think...
Don't remind us, by the way.
I think what's in the movie is representative. In other words, yeah, there are a few, but there are other jokes as right. well, and there are some very light moments, and there are some serious moments. And you know, I had a lot of footage, and I my challenge was not to skew it in one way or another. I didn't want to glorify him, but I didn't want to do a hatchet job either. So I really tried to find kind of the best moments and the moments that kind of help push the story forward. So. Yeah, there are a few, but the tour wasn't nonstop, you know,
right.
Jay Leno jokes. They had a show to make, and they had other things to do. So, on the balance, if it's whatever 2% Jay jokes in the movie, that's probably what it was backstage.
Yeah. But that's smart because you know I'm sure there was maybe you wanted to put more of that stuff in because that's the stuff you know will get some media play.
Right.
If there are ten comments where all he does is rip Jay to shreds, you know if you put those in there that the documentary might get a couple more media hits, a couple more people might write about it.
Is it too late?
Well, no. But the thing is that you.
Damn.
You exactly. But the thing is that
Where were you when I was cutting this?
No, you know what? I'm available. Okay. I can be bought. You thought about the film. The film came first.
Yes.
You know, and what I did like about the film a lot was that it didn't try to be this. You know, you didn't throw things in there just to show the bitterness, just to get those brief little hits of bitterness, just because you felt as if it'll, you know, get people stand up in their seats, you know, get their attention.
Right.
It really is sort of representative of the amount of time he spent being bitter.
Yeah.
It seems like, you know.
I think that's true.
He didn't wallow for five months.
He didn't wallow for 5 months, and it's hard to do a show. You know, there was a show to do. And I think the movie shows that as well. And I think, you know, if I had, I my struggle was really to not show what the filmmaker's agenda was. And if I did make it a parade of Jay Leno jokes, I think that would, be obvious that was, you know, hey, you know, let's all make fun of Jay Leno.
In the modern day, when you're shooting
a few more hits.
In the modern day, when you're shooting a documentary, I'm assuming you shot digital.
I did.
So are you editing on the road, or is this something that you're editing in your head as you're going, you know, like, this is great, this is going to make it, or are you going back to the hotel room at night and opening up the MacBook and doing some work?
There were a few scenes that in the hotel room at night I did go back and just to look at, but I really didn't edit it until I got back home once the tour ended, and I edited it in my garage, much like this garage. So,
but you've got 400 hours of whatever it is of footage.
149
hours of footage.
Yeah.
You've got to sit down.
This is going to be 400 hours.
Exactly. Well, we're on about 270 now.
Let me ask a quick question that relates to from the chat room. Let's take a couple chat room.
Okay.
Beatmaster 80 wants to know, since you just said 400 hours, so you said?
He said 400 hours.
Oh, you said 400 hours. Like, you've got how many hours? Like,
149.
There you go. 149. Will we get a bonus video, DVD, Blu-ray of all those extended scenes that we're not going to see in the movie?
There will be a DVD, and there will be some amazing extras on the DVD. And the extras on the DVD are actual cut scenes. They're not just... extra lines. Sometimes you'll see a DVD bonus material, and it's the same scene, but just like an extra angle or an extra shot. There are whole sequences that I cut and then just cut out of the movie, and then once we finished the movie, I went back and tweaked them a little more. For example, he tweeted the announce of the TBS show, and everyone's there, Sona's there, and the band is there, and the band did not know that they were going to have a new job. And it's a remarkable scene, and there was just I cut it out of the movie because I really wanted the movie to be about the live show, and I thought it was a little repetitive of the other tweet scene in the movie. But that will be a DVD extra. There'll be some others as well.
Is there any more? The big question I had watching the movie. Conan talks to Reggie Watts once in the movie. Mm-hmm. Is there more Reggie Watts in any of these deleted scenes? Because he's amazing.
Reggie Watts is fantastic. Reggie Watts was Conan's opening act. Brilliant. Completely unexpected. I mean, he's really in that kind of Andy Kaplan tradition. And yeah. And I hope to include a few of his numbers in the in the DVD.
Some great stuff.
And you said, I think Chad was asking, but I think you said it. Conan and you and Andy did the commentary, correct?
Yeah, the commentary is me, Conan, Andy, Mike Sweeney, who's in the movie, and Sona, Conan's assistant, and a bottle of Chardonnay. We were all doing the commentary.
Best kind of commentary.
Yeah, exactly.
Best commentary.
That's right. So, as we sort of wrap it up, and then we'll move on. Hopefully, you'll stay.
No, I'm just. Come on. I'm like Larry King. I'm just getting started.
Just getting warmed up.
We have to have him on for as long as he sat there and watched us.
Right.
We don't have that much time.
It's the one-to-one rule.
I have to be at work tomorrow. Is there anything that you learned from Conan just about dealing with adversity? Because here you have a guy who's got to manage and work through a lot of pain and bitterness and whatever else he's going through. Just from a personal level, did you learn anything about how to process, pain or disappointment just by watching him do it?
I wish I could handle things as elegantly as he does. There's a scene in the movie where these two kids who've driven a long way come up to him and they say something pretty horrible. They drop a racial slur, which was against my people, by the way, and I'm shooting, and I thought he handled that with such grace. I'm not the man he is. I tend to kind of just get migraines and. And then take it out on everyone around me. But I think his parting words when he finished The Tonight Show were, just be kind, be kind. And I think he is. I mean, he teases a lot of people, but I think genuinely he's a kind person. I think no one leaves those teasing sessions in tears. Everyone kind of laughs and enjoys it. So
that is the one thing where no matter what he would say, you would get the sense that it was all just a bunch of joshing. That's just his way. You never felt as if he was really angry at his assistant necessarily, really angry at Jeff Ross.
No, he wasn't. And I mean, he's a perfectionist. Conan O'Brien is a perfectionist's perfectionist, and he has very high standards for himself, and he has the same high standards for everyone around him. So if he gives the people around him crap, you just know what he's giving himself is 100 times worse.
It is true a lot of times in comedy, when you deal with those people, and Mike's been there too, that when they make fun of you, that means they like you.
Yeah.
It's when they ignore you or they're serious with you, especially in comedy, that they don't really think very highly of you. But when they bust your chops or they goof on you, there's a certain affection there. It means that they do like you.
Uh-huh. That's very true. And I mean, because there's a comfortableness, you know, it shows that they feel comfortable enough to do that. I felt like I became part of the group when Conan punched me. He did punch me at one point.
You know, Conan punches a lot of people in this film.
There's a lot of punching in this movie.
Yeah, and when I got mine, I felt like I made it.
You said you did it all in your edit. You shot it. You edit it. One man band.
Yeah.
Final cut. Does Conan look at it and get final say? Does he? You know, who gets the final cut? Really, is the question.
I did. I mean, what you see on the screen is the director's cut. Really.
That's great.
It's. I mean, there were some things that you see in the movie that I thought he would be uncomfortable with, but. You know, maybe he's crazy. I don't know, but he was. I think he knows that people and fans can smell bullshit a mile away. And I think as soon as something seems sanitized, it loses its legitimacy.
Right.
And he wasn't interested in that. He wasn't interested in a puff piece. And I think something that was sanitized would ultimately alienate his fans more than something that was honest.
Sure. Sure. Well, here's the thing. Conan O'Brien Can't Stop is a terrific documentary. It's really one of the best it's probably the best documentary I've seen this year, actually. You know, it's funny. It's a very unique snapshot of this person's psyche at a very unique time in his life. This is something that no performer has ever gone through. A performer may never go through something like this again. A complete public bizarre episode in TV history was played out in front of American audiences for a number of weeks, mm-hmm. with spillover into David Letterman and spillover into Jay Leno, and of course Conan had to deal with it on air every night. You go through all that pain and all that rejection and all that drama and still have to put on a show, a Tonight Show, one of the crown jewels of all television, every single night. And you know, the way Rodman shot it, the way he put it together, it really honors what Conan actually went through. You know, and I think as a document, I think it'll stand as a great, really distillation of this moment. You know, just as much as the Bill Carter, you know, book.
Yeah.
You know, the Bill Carter book was terrific. You know, and I think that this film is as essential to understanding what happened as the Bill Carter book.
Well, the Bill Carter book is a terrific book, and that's where I point people. When anyone asks me about, well, you know, why didn't you know, say more about Jay Leno or the NBC executives or, you know, name this person? I said, well, Bill Carter did that very well, and that wasn't happening right in front of my eyes. I wanted to capture what was happening.
Well, I think what's really interesting about the movie is that, I mean, even if you don't know any of this stuff, it's a really terrific examination of the creative process and sort of the weirdness that drives somebody like that who wants to be up on stage. I just found it fascinating that there's this guy who's a comedian, and all he wants to do, so many comedians are like this, all he wants to do is play music. He mm-hmm. wants to play so much music, and it's that performer thing. It's just, I think this film really fascinatingly examines that performer's psyche
right.
in a really open way.
I wondered if he would turn into Mike Douglas, who sang. Didn't Mike Douglas sing
yes.
every show? And Merv Griffin and
Dinosaur
would sing. Yeah,
just they want to sing.
Right.
He's pretty good.
He's not bad. Yeah. He can play guitar really well and keep up with people like Brian Setzer. And so yeah, I'm so relieved you liked it, man. If you'd hated it, this would have been so different.
No, you know what? There was nothing not to like. Conan O'Brien Can't Stop.
Yeah, we'll have the review up. We will tag this. You can also see Mark's review.
Wait a minute. You know, Mike always makes fun of me for not Facebooking, but I Facebooked a link to my print review.
Yeah, we don't care about your print review. Facebook the link to our review.
I don't know what
to your video review. That doesn't help us at all.
Rodman, actually, I got blurbed. I got blurbed.
I did. You were top blurb.
That's right.
I was the top blurb.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Box office.
You're top blurb.
Thank you very much. All right. Rodman, thank you very much.
Okay.
It's a great documentary.
You're going to stick around. We do a next segment called Buy, Rent, or Burn.
Sure.
Where we name off DVDs and you tell us if we should buy it, rent it, or burn it.
Okay.
You want to stick around for that?
Absolutely.
Excellent.
A little awkward
being
critical of another director's work, but I'll give it a go. What the heck?
Well, then you know what? It's time for Buy, Rent, or Burn. See, that cues the graphic. That's how professional we are.
Critical of the director as a person and not their work.
Yeah.
I think that's the better way to do it. Like, that guy's a dick.
Okay.
All right.
But the movie's all right.
So here's how it works. We ask you to put movies up on DVDs, basically, or now streaming, live streaming, not live, you know, instant streaming, up on our Facebook page, facebook.com/stupidformovies. Name a movie. Mark, Devin, Rodman has never seen this list before. I will read it to him, and you tell me if you should buy it, rent it, or burn it. So the first one
buy
is...
Buy it.
Wait, no, I'm not. The first one is from Crisette Loretta on Facebook. Six people like this idea. Actually, there was somebody else asked it. Beat Morgenthaler asked the same exact one in the same strand, not looking apparently. But Mirror Mask.
That's the Mirror Mask. That was the one, the Jim Henson film. He didn't obviously direct it, but
Dave,
the
Dave McKean.
Yeah, the Jim Henson production house. They, you know what? The thing with Mirror Mask, and you know, I'll be curious to see what Devin thinks, is that Mirror Mask, it's a bit like the movie we talked about earlier, Zardoz, where it's got all these crazy ideas, but I don't know that they come together in an altogether satisfying way. So I would say Rent.
You know, it's really interesting. It's super fucking boring, and I think you should rent it if you have problems sleeping at night.
So that's probably a burn.
Wow. Do you know Mirror Mask?
I don't know it, and I don't have trouble sleeping at night thanks to Ambien. So.
Done. Ambien's so buy good. Ambien.
By the way, Ambien, that's a buy on Ambien. Cue the graphic.
Yeah.
Many overnight flights, Ambien saves my ass.
Lance Taylor, six people liking his on Facebook, The Rocketeer, which is celebrating its 20th anniversary.
Well, here's the big question, right? So are you talking about, like, buy the current one? Because they just remastered this movie.
Probably.
And
20th
anniversary. There's going to be a Blu-ray that I think is going to be coming, and it's a terrific old-fashioned-y fun film that I think people maybe now will enjoy. When it came out, like, 93, Joe Johnston directed, he was directing Captain America this summer. It's sort of a tenth throwback at the pulp stuff, and based on Dave Stevens' Rocketeer comic, and it has Jennifer Connelly back when she was much more pneumatic as an actress, and I think it's a lot of fun, but I would wait for the Blu-ray, which I think is coming.
I would agree with that. I do like the film. Good early James Horner score, by the way.
Awesome. Awesome score.
Says Corey Levin. So I will say wait for the Blu-ray, like Devin says, and then rent it.
All right.
Rocketeer.
I will rent the Blu-ray unless it's really cheap. And then I'll buy it. Because I did like it. I thought the art direction was terrific. I thought he did a great job of maintaining a tone throughout the entire movie. And that's, you know, as a director, that's sort of the biggest challenge, is to keep a consistent tone throughout the whole movie. And Jennifer Connelly, gorgeous. Absolutely gorgeous.
Nothing wrong there.
All right.
It's Disney. It won't be cheap. So just rent it.
Clint Sanders, five people on Facebook like his Hellraiser.
The original?
We'll say the original.
This is a good question. There's like so many different versions on DVD.
I'm going to say the original Hellraiser.
It's terrific.
I don't like those types of movies.
So what, is that a burn or a rent?
You know, it's a pinhead. He's got pins
so
in his head.
Burn?
I don't know. Just burn it.
Wow, that was very...
Hellraiser, you know, I love those kinds of movies. I'm not a fan of Hellraiser. So, you know, and Hell, come on, Hellraiser should burn. Is there anything more
for
Hellraiser than burn?
It's all coming together.
Javelle Dion Dixon asks, Million Dollar Baby.
Burn it.
You know what? I actually don't like, you know what? I wouldn't say burn it, but I'm with Devin that I get it a little bit, but I'd say rent it. Meh, you know, whatever.
All right.
I wasn't thrilled with it.
Clint Eastwood movie?
Yeah. Yes.
Rent it. Yeah.
All right.
Ape of the trash.
Jeremy Aruda asked about Creepshow.
When Ted Danson's tied up underwater, that was awesome.
You just gave away an ending.
That was like the first 20, but that was the first chapter. Yeah. He's all tied, right? Maybe he's all tied
never,
up.
Never, yeah. Leslie Nielsen drowns Ted Danson.
Yes. Gotta buy. You know what? I like
terrific.
I like Creepshow. I admit it. Buy
the show.
Mark, I didn't expect that.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah. Oh, and then his head is above the.
Everybody saying buy.
I love it. I'll buy. Yeah, Creepshow 1 and Creepshow 2. I'm a fan of Creepshow 2.
Creepshow 2 has got some really good stuff in it. Yeah.
Hey, lady.
It's got the wooden Indian. It's good stuff.
Oh, let's do a couple more. So beat Morgenthaler. Oh no, he also asked about Mirror Mask. We already did that. So let's move on to the Ustream chat. E. Alvarez, 88, Some Kind of Monster.
The Metallica documentary.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I would rent it.
It's great. I'd buy it. I have bought it. I think I have bought it too,
but I would rent
it. I like Metallica a lot, and I like the documentary. So I'd say buy it. Here's the thing. If you're asking about it, you obviously like Metallica, so just go ahead and buy it.
But you know what? I'm not a big Metallica fan. My musical tastes run more to the Beach Boys. But I love that movie. I don't think you need to be a Metallica fan. I think that's a fascinating movie.
Yeah, well, that's another movie that's a really interesting look inside a creative process, and also a movie that they're not afraid of kind of making them look like douchebags.
Yeah.
It's sort of, they really don't necessarily come across as the image of Metallica. There's crying, and there's like complaining, and... there's Lars Ulrich being like the most annoying guy who ever lived.
All right, two more, and we'll go to the YouTube, youtube.com, Streaming Garage. Please subscribe. Two more, and then we're out of here from YouTube chat. Plan 9 from Outer Space. From Nick Money asked about.
Well,
that.
You know, it's what are you gonna say? It's Plan 9. I mean, it's a horrible movie, but that's the idea. It's a classic because it sucks, and so buy it.
You gotta have it. You have to have it in your library for parties and.
Probably like $2.
Yeah.
I think is it not public domain?
We gotta
There's
find out.
There's a remake
We have another show, like Super Scary Horror Theater, where we show public domain movies and do comedy sketches in between.
Yeah, it might be public
breaks.
Domain.
You know, I don't think it's public domain.
Is it not?
Because a friend of mine had done a musical, Plan 9, a really terrific musical, kind of in the style of Little Shop of Horrors musical, and there were rights issues, and so I don't think it's public domain.
Ah. Although I would do this. I would buy Plan 9 and then buy Ed Wood. Tim Burton's best film.
I am being told by Elaine Ewing, who also produces Super Scary Horror Theater with me, Plan 9 is in fact public domain. It's on our list of movies we're going to
do. It might have dropped off after your friend did it.
Maybe.
It might just come around.
Maybe.
So download it from the internet then in that case.
That's when they just didn't bother to re-up it or something?
Yeah, maybe. Well, watch Super Scary Horror Theater. Maybe we'll do it in a couple weeks.
But don't get the colorized. Someone colorized.
Oh, no, it's never
horrible.
Do, yeah.
It's terrible.
Somebody colorized Night of the Living Dead.
Yeah.
John Russo added new scenes.
Right. That's public domain.
That's horrible. Okay, one more. From, I think it's Kajay.
Keep them coming. Come on.
I can keep going. Well, look in the chat.
Who's complaining about the three-hour show? Everybody at this table.
All right. Kajay Kamsama asked about, from YouTube chat, Disney's Hunchback of Notre Dame.
I've never seen it.
I haven't seen it.
Nobody has kids?
But I like the Charles Laughton one. That's
good.
That's not one of my favorites. You know what? If you've used up all the other Disney films, you know, you've seen The Lion King, and you've seen The Beauty and the Beast, and you're down to the dregs. Hunchback.
All right. I just asked in the chat room for one more. Okay, this keeps getting asked, and this is obvious, but okay. Emin Nielsen asked about Office Space.
You know, I was late to the Office Space train. When I saw it, I didn't think it was funny, but now I think it's funny. I admit it.
You're a joiner.
It's good. It's a buy, but it's sort of obvious. Yeah, it's sort of.
Yeah, it's an obvious buy.
Yeah, buy. It's a good movie. It's very funny. Flair. I wish I had my flair on.
All right, one more from Mike Rotman's ex. I don't know who this is, but they come on every week. They keep calling themselves my ex. All my exes are crazy. Labyrinth.
Sure.
David Bowie.
David Bowie.
Yeah. You know, it's not as good as I remembered it being. It recently came out on Blue or something, I think, and I recorded it. It's interesting. It's definitely a rent, especially if you want to see, like, this huge codpiece on David Bowie, because he's got, as the Goblin King, this giant cock and balls going on.
Sort of like a Gene Simmons kind of codpiece thing?
You know what? It's like way creepier. Wow. He's creepier than Gene Simmons.
All right.
And wasn't Jennifer Connelly in that?
Also, she's too young to say that she's attractive. It's creepy if we say
but
that.
But she's good. You know what? I actually sat next to Jennifer Connelly on a bus that was going to a World Series game, and I sat next to Jennifer Connelly, and I said, you know, I loved you in Creepers, which is this phenomenon, this Dario Argento movie, which I think she made even before.
Yeah, that might have been her very, very, very first movie.
She got up and changed seats.
That's amazing.
That's great.
I think I scared her. Yeah,
that's fantastic.
She should be so proud of working on Argento. That is one of the highlights of her whole career.
Dario Argento, this is where Devin and I part company. Dario Argento, don't get it. Don't like Giallo, don't like the whole thing. How much James Franciscus can one guy watch?
And that's it for Byron and Byrne!
And that's it for Byron and Byrne! Alright, that's Mike's way of saying we're done.
Wrap it up. Otherwise, I'll never hear the end of it from Mark.
Can we talk about, I want to talk about documentaries some more. Now, Nanook of the North, let's go back a little bit. I want to start with that.
I think our new show is stupid for documentaries.
Okay.
You know what I think is really interesting, and I'm going to do this, I'm going to take over your show right now,
please.
Is that I think that there's a continuing battle in the pop culture of what a documentary is. And there are people who say that what Michael Moore does is not documentary because it is opinion oriented. Mm-hmm. And I say you're retarded because that is in fact what a documentary can be. As long as it's nonfiction, that's technically a documentary. Where do you come down on?
It's tricky. Whenever you choose to turn the camera on and off, you're making a decision.
Right.
So of course they're documentaries. But I also think Dario Argento makes documentaries, you know. So
of witches.
Of witches, exactly. You know.
Dario Argento. Ending the show on such a lame note. Unless you're Devin, who loves Dario Argento.
Wow.
Okay, Mother of Tears, buy, rent, or
burn.
Oh,
Mother of Tears.
Burn.
Oh, see?
Look, I got to say, I'm sorry.
The love is not complete. All right, first of all, thank you, Devin Faraci. He was fantastic.
Yeah.
Great opinions. Awesome. Thank you. Rodman Flender, please, guys, Conan O'Brien can't stop. Obviously, as a documentary, it's not getting the Transformers distribution that it deserves. But it's got a DVD. Is it a Blu-ray or just DVD? It's a Blu-ray, right?
Isn't DVD. Everything? I mean, that's later in September. It's in theaters this weekend. Right. It's in theaters now, so go see it.
But when it comes out on DVD/Blu-ray, get that too.
Wrapping it up, we had two burns this weekend, so to me, it seems like you want it. Conan O'Brien Can't Stop.
That's the pick of the week.
That's the pick of the week.
That's the pick of the week.
Movie to see this weekend, long weekend, holiday weekend, so go see it.
It's downright American to see Conan O'Brien Can't Stop in theaters this 4th of July weekend.
He's an American success story. He comes from two really wealthy parents and became a huge success.
Right? Wow. That's the Horatio Alger story. It's just fantastic. All right, guys. Kickstarter.com's stupid for garages. What's it called?
Streaming Garage.
Kickstarter.com, Streaming Garage.
You can produce that last segment. Buy, rent, or burn. You want to produce it? That's available as a Kickstarter reward.
That
you come in. I don't produce it. You come in, you get to do it on Skype, or if you live in LA, you could come in and you get to name every buy, rent, or burn yourself, and that's one of the rewards. We only have 5 available of that reward. So I think a couple of people. I think Corey Levin's mom actually did it.
Oh yeah, that's right.
She did. So we only have a couple of those left. So you want to get a Kickstarter and actually do that, because I get a lot of complaints. You didn't pick my buy, rent, or burn. That's a big Kickstarter reward we're giving away.
All right. So thank you, Devin. Thank you, Robin. Thank you, crew. Less than 3 hours, folks. We did it. We'll see you next time. Yeah!